咱们的 QQ 是荣光路门口，那么的咱们门口前面是有的天马的总监今天就是以他接把他忙把他在三间他接给我这个靠我的娘家的接把他接给大哥这个老妈他确实能不起经营一面这导致了我们以如果缺呢三间的钱你能不去跟三万多这个缺把钱我不能给忙不错的没有那么你送把他直接去送给你送不多送去
So he found himself at this golden temple at at Trikung Til, and so had that was a vision now, and so here in his vision the temple itself manifested to him as the Dharma Lord, which is Trikung Sumgun, and so then he offered many prostrations to him, and so actually nowadays also in this main seat of the Trikung Kagyu there is a very special statue of Trikung Sumgun that also contains some heart relics and so on. And so in any case, what he's saying here is that he gives a personal account of this vision, and he's saying, so after having offered prostrations to him, then some people actually claim that very many profound things happened, that I have received empowerments, transmissions and instructions from Yidams and Dharma protectors and so on. However, he says that this actually is not an accurate account of what had really happened, because in fact the Guru is the very essence of all the Buddhas of the three times of past, present and future, and that is he is the Lord of all samsara and nirvana, and if one only practices and offers to that Guru, the Vajra Master, one is closer to awakening by a billion times than if one were to make offerings to all those Buddhas. So then he said that no, it is greater to realize one's own mind to be the guru than to offer to countless Buddhas, Bodhisattvas and Dharma protectors. That is more profound than all the outer appearance of Yidams and Buddhas and so on. Because the root of samsara and nirvana is your own mind, and you will not find an actual guru elsewhere. And so, and therefore, he said that practice your own mind as the root guru, and with this, I'm inspired by this realization that occurred during this pure vision, then he offered this practice, this very special practice of the Guru Yoga, which represents the condensed essence of both the sutras and the tantras, and therefore it is in itself a complete and sufficient path.
Thank you.
So then for the purpose in order to benefit beings, he offered this profound path of the Devadvaji Guru Yoga, consisting of an outer, inner, and secret practice. And the outer practice is said is the source of blessings, and that is the practice of we visualize the Buddha Shakyamuni. The inner practice is the natural liberation of samsara and nirvana, and here we visualize Vajradhara. And the secret practice is the ocean of primordial wisdom, and here we visualize a red form of Chakrasamvara, which actually is the Guru Devadvaja, but resembles the form of Chakrasamvara. And then the suchness practice is the perfection of the transcendence of all elaborations. So that is, you realize that the actual Guru is your own mind itself. And then he gave various other branches of practice, like the practices of channels and winds, the completion stage and practices, which is fast and free from limitations, then practices to remove obstacles, and practices to engender enlightened activities in order to guide others with altruism. This is what he spoke in the immediacy of this pure vision. And actually it is quite extensive. It is actually quite a large volume of instructions. Basically, he gave instructions consisting of 9 points, which are called the mother and the child, or the source and the result, comprising the entire path. And that exists now in various extensive and concise forms. However, he warns in this text that one should never alter the length of the text to suit one's own personal needs. For example, one should not just shorten or lengthen something, but one should practice just according to the instructions of the actual text. So then it is said that it is some empowerment should be given to fortunate disciples whose number should not exceed 25 and that should be odd in number, for example, 1 or 3 or 9, 17 and so on, up to 25 and so on. And so, however, it is said that one should not just receive the empowerment and then just leave it with that, but having received the empowerment, there's also a commitment of actually engaging in this practice at least for one session a day. And so there's different kinds of practices. There is more extensive sadhanas and more short sadhanas. You can also practice just a short sadhana, but at least you should recite it once a day and practice it once a day. And if you cannot do that, actually it is better if you do not receive the empowerment, because then the receiving of the empowerment is of not much benefit. Actually, we made this announcement yesterday, so you're probably aware of it. There's the Om Mahung practice that is contained in a short sadhana. So at the very least, you should do a brief session of that on a day-to-day basis. So this is what we have already announced yesterday. Mention again that the motivation is extremely important. For example, in the Dharmapada, it is said that whatever you practice beforehand as a preliminary, you must consider others as more important. So it is said in this text that you become like a chariot or like a bearing wheel is pulled by an ox. So wherever the ox goes, he takes this chariot with him. Likewise, the motivation is really what determines which way you go. And so it is also said that the motivation of virtue and non-virtue determines whether or not your actions are virtue or evil. So if your motivation is not completely pure, then even if you practice the Dharma, it will not become genuine Dharma. So it is really important to pay really close attention to that. And most of the time, we just mention it briefly, but often we hear that, but we never actually apply this to practice. It remains something that is rather artificial to us. However, it is important to actually put it into practice. And therefore, I thought about sharing a few words about this.
Number one,
Story that I wanted to mention is that once when His Holiness said when I came to somewhere in the West, then some of the disciples wanted to organize an event, like a teaching event, in also associated with like a celebration, more like a party and so on. So where there's a lot of points in the program, and actually that was for the purpose of gathering a lot of people. And at that time, I said that I'm not willing to do that, because the only goal you have is that many people come, and then it actually becomes more like a business to get more money, and then actually nobody thinks about the benefit of those people. So you just invite a lama that has is a little bit famous. You organize a very fancy event in order to get a lot of people. For example, people in organize like a Dzambala empowerment because they think many people will come, and then when many people come, they will get a lot of offerings, and that is not the correct motivation. And then the Dharma becomes like a business, and the lama becomes like an item that you're selling for that business. And what else can it be than negative karma? So therefore, I actually declined that, and I said that you can have your separate celebrations, your events, but do not call it, announce it as a Dharma event, because the Buddha had said that of the body, speech, and mind, the mind is most important. And therefore, this is something we always have to remember. Even if you think that, actually it's not my own purpose, it's for the purpose of the Dharma Center, it's still not a completely pure motivation, because in this way the Dharma of the Buddha really becomes an actual business. And for that purpose, even if it is for a center, it should not be used. So it is really very important to pay close attention to always have a pure motivation.
Yeah.
So this one time, also another time I was in Nepal, actually recently, and I was on the 15th day, which is the full moon, I was doing circumambulation of the Bodh Stupa, and so at that time I met William, seems to be a very big businessman. He was maybe Tibetan or Nepali, and so he was making a lot of offerings to the stupa, many lamp offerings, thousands of different offerings and incense and so on. And so I was watching him, observing him, how he was conducting himself, and so he actually seemed to be very busy, going back and forth, putting offerings here, putting offerings there, but it seems that his mind was somewhere else. He just like was putting stuff to the stupa without thinking about it really. And so at that time I really felt that this is not really sincere, and this is not he doesn't really connect to the offering. Another day I went to the Svayambhu stupa also in Nepal early before sunrise in the morning, and there I met there's this tradition in Nepal often that in small villages some people who are Nepali Buddhists are doing small fire pujas. And so I went to watch one morning, and so there was this young girl around 10 years of age, just wearing cheap sandals, and she was making these small and cheap butter lamp offerings in front of a very nice Tara statue, and the way she did it was very graceful. She lit these lamps, and she folded her hands, and she made her prayers, and she placed the lamp there. And at that time I really felt that really the blessings of Tara and her devotion, her prayers, really actually met, they really actually connected. And I really felt that she really received the blessings of Tara. It's just like a match is lit by fire. It actually is actually some, there's a connection taking place. And so this is how we should think when we practice the Dharma. It is really mainly the mind, not the extent of the offerings, but really how we connect to the practice in our mind. Therefore, a pure motivation is most important, and the number of accumulations, for example, is secondary. We cannot only focus on the activities of body and speech. The mind is most important, because otherwise, how can we ever change our mind? For example, even if you spend in a three-year retreat and only focus on completing the certain numbers of recitations, if you do not actually feel that in your mind, if you do not directly connect to it with fierce devotion in your mind, then the practice will not be genuine, and there will be not much power from having done this practice. And so, of course, there is a benefit of engaging in virtuous activities of body and speech, but still the mind is most important. And so it is really the benefit of practice, the power of practice really only comes about when we connect our mind directly to the practice. It is just like you target the mind. And so otherwise, if we do not do that, it is very difficult to hit the essence of our mind. So therefore, I would like to reiterate that when we engage in this practice, it is really very important that you pay very close attention to your motivation that you actually have, your state of mind, because only then will you be able to actually connect to the practice. And only when you connect to the practice will you actually be able to generate the power of the practice. And so again, the motivation, the state of mind is really most important in actually whatever you do.
Это всегда есть время на воздействие, где ты живешь, да, с объектом, где ты живешь.